and that's at 7 o'clock here in the church. It will be streamed online via a Facebook page, because we do know that perhaps some people might not want to come out into the night, or some people may feel that coming to church in the current COVID situation is enough for one day. So it will be live streamed later on. However, if you do want to come along in person to attend to the member service, you'll be made most welcome. It's a time where we come together to remember those people that we have lost and loved. There'll be Bible readings, there'll be pieces of poetry, which is all pertinent to love, grief and loss. There will be a time during the service where we'll remember everybody that the minister has conducted a funeral for within a parish over the last year, and there'll also be a time when we will remember by saying out loud the names of those people who have been passed forward to me. There still is time to get a name included in that list tonight. You just pass it to me or the minister, or there will be a way to do it tonight if you come along in person. But as the little note in the order of service says, it's a safe place and a quiet place. And it's a time to remember loved ones lost recently or some time ago. So I do commend that to you, and if you're able to come along or pass the details on, albeit the date that happens, that would be lovely, because it is quite a meaningful time together, and as I say, it will be available online afterwards. Thank you.
Thanks, Alan. No, that thing. Thanks for that, Alan. Hey, good morning, everyone. I do extend a very warm welcome to you all, and any visitors who are with us this morning, do hope you enjoyed the service this morning. And also, anyone viewing online, we do hope you enjoyed the service. A few informations, if you bear with me. The first is the Guild. The Guild is back up and running again now. They meet tomorrow at 1:30 in the hall, and it's a bring and buy sale. And Liz tells me, if you bring a new member, you get extra points. Okay, so it's a bring and buy sale tomorrow at the Guild.
I won't get one.
And well, we're going to have a proposed, but essentially we need to have a communion service in December. It's on Sunday the 12th of December here in the church. So because of the COVID situation, it will be slightly different the way the elements will be handed out, etc. But we'll give you more details of that. So just stick it in your diary. Sunday the 12th of December, part of the service will have the act of Holy Communion. Also at this time of the year, I know Helen used to do the shoeboxes, all these things. These have all been put up in the air now because of the COVID situation. But there are still people who are less fortunate than us in the community. And a couple of organisations are organising bits and pieces to try and help the people less fortunate ourselves. It's the YMCA, they're preparing what they call Christmas hampers. So if anyone has any donations of any food, etc. for Christmas, could they bring them along to church anytime, and I'll make sure they're given down to the YMCA. And North Lanarkshire Council's Social Work Department are also hoping to send out Christmas parcels. Again, any donations of toys or toiletries, things like that, that they can give out to the less fortunate at Christmas. So if anyone has anything at all, bring it along to church next Sunday or the following Sunday, and I'll make sure it gets to the appropriate destination. That's all the information this morning. Thank you very much indeed for your attention.
Thank you.
Today is the feast of Christ the King, and so the theme is of Christ's kingship. You're invited to join in the words that are printed in bold. Come to worship Jesus Christ, Alpha and Omega, the one who was, who is, and is to come. Come to worship the one who is just. Come to worship Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth. We come to worship Jesus Christ, King of kings and Lord of lords, to whom be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Our hymn that continues in that theme, King of kings, majesty, as we continue in worship of Christ who reveals God to us.
Even as we
come to the end of this liturgical cycle, having spent time with Mark reflecting on your humanity, the reminder that you share our vulnerability and enter our suffering and our struggle, that you are the one who today, listening attentively to John's witness, the one who is able to stand before all the powers of the world, stand with dignity and poise and integrity and a power marked by love, to say, everyone is welcome in your kingdom. And so we come, not because we are particularly holy or have it all together, but because we know everything there is to know about God and life and goodness and truth and grace, but we come because we know that we need your touch. Come because there is a stirring within us that we long for a just and righteous king. There is a stirring within us where we long to be made whole by someone who has sufficient power to restore us to fellowship with God. We come because we know that even though our prayers and our words and our phrases seem so limited and even broken, there is something about you that takes all that we offer and makes of it something new and glorious. And so in the silence we steady our lives and reflect on them in light of who you are, and we make our confession. For those days when we have settled for the ho-hum and the routine, we have simply accepted things for what they are and have seldom found the strength to challenge power, give us renewed strength, Lord, to live lives marked by your reign. For those days when we have belittled others and belittled ourselves, where we have forgotten that we are created in the image of God, where we have lost our way, come and stir within us a reminder that we are indeed children of a remarkable King. Those days when we have forgotten how fierce your love truly is, and that you are God who proves jealous for all that you have created and have entered into its story, and so from that place of shared vulnerability and identification you have transformed all things, come and help us to receive your forgiveness, your healing, your grace and your love. Make of this hour of worship an experience where we are truly open to your spirit and offering ourselves we might recognize that we truly belong to a family that is marked by a variety of languages and cultures, a variety of races and expressions, a variety of experience and stories. Truly, we share a remarkable family that have been taught to pray in your name this prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen. Our psalm today, a relatively brief one, the 93rd psalm. The Lord reigns, he is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and armed with strength. Indeed, the world is established firm and secure. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, Lord. The seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves. Mightier than the thunder of the great waters. Mightier than the breakers of the sea. The Lord on high is mighty. Your statutes, Lord, stand firm. Holiness adorns your house for endless days. Stand and sing together in response to God's word, beautiful Saviour, all my day.
Living forever and ever, and was presented to him.
He was given authority, honour and royal power, so that the peoples of all nations, races and languages would serve him. His authority would last forever, and his kingdom would never end. So it comes as no surprise that the early Christian community saw in that particular heavenly figure the character, the presence, the ministry, the authority of Jesus Christ. And in Mark's Gospel, for instance, Jesus himself takes on that title repeatedly, the Son of Man. John reflects on it after years of worship. We find our reading in John chapter 18 from verse 33 onwards. Pilate went back into the palace, called Jesus and asked, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Does this question come from you, or have others told you about me?" Pilate replied, "Do you think I'm a Jew? Was your own people, the chief priests, who handed you over to me? What have you done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom belonged to this world, my followers would fight to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish authorities. No, my kingdom does not belong here." So Pilate asked him, "Are you a king then?" Jesus answered, "You say that I'm a king. I was born and came into the world for this one purpose, to speak about the truth. Whoever belongs to the truth listens to me." "And what is truth?" Pilate asked. And then, at about the same time, probably a different author, but still named John, the great Revelation and the Apocalypse, just a few verses from the first chapter. "From John to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace be yours from God who is, who was, and who is to come, from the seven spirits in front of his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the first to be raised from death, and who is also the ruler of the kings of the world. He loves us, and by his sacrificial death he has freed us from our sins and made us a kingdom of priests to serve his God and Father. To Jesus Christ be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming on the clouds. Everyone will see him, including those who pierced him. All people on earth will mourn over him. So shall it be. I am the first and the last, says the Lord God Almighty, who is, who was, and who is to come. Amen." I suppose, to be simplistic, there are essentially two ways of viewing the reality of the world in which we live and the unfolding universe of which we are a part. And that is a sense that it is an endless cycle. Some scientists argue, for instance, that there is a repeated motion of big bangs one upon the other that arouse a multiplicity of universes. And the universe has always been here and is constantly flowing from one universe. I'm no scientist, and so I'm in no position to offer a meaningful argument to such speculations. But speculations they are, because in so many ways, none of us know. The Hebrew imagination, however, that has inspired in turn the Christian proclamation is that there is a point. Right at the beginning of Genesis, for instance, it is offered, "In the beginning, God." God created all that there is. There is a moment, a specific moment, where life flourishes and life is allowed to be. And so from that point, everything moves down throughout human stories and human communities, where people reflect on the possibility of holiness and justice and righteousness and truth and morality and love and grace and belonging and community. And so we find ourselves as part of that remarkable river, gathering to worship, standing, to borrow an expression, on the shoulders of giants, of those who have preceded us, and gathered in moments of prayer and reflection and worship, and said, "What manner of God is this?" And so in the context of that, our three readings come from a period where indeed history is being shaken up, and there is a possibility of a new beginning. Many of our hymns have spoken of it as well in today's service. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, soon we will find ourselves in Advent, where we will find that reinforced once again. Is there another voice that speaks to us? Is there a voice that addresses us from beyond and speaks powerfully of God's grace and goodness? We in the Christian faith tradition say, Amen. Yes, God who is the one who was, and is the one who is to come. The God who begins all things will complete all things, and he does so in Jesus Christ, who is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the Son of Man, the one who comes in glory, the one who will restore all things. Hallelujah. That's our most appropriate response. And so, as we end one lectionary cycle and then given glimpses of a new season that starts next week in Advent, we proclaim Christ is King. But what manner of King and what type of kingdom? It is a question that the church itself has wrestled with, society wrestles with, and yes, each one of us wrestles with, whether we know it or not. Every day when we're living out our lives, we're asking questions about power and love, about who we shall serve, about who we shall listen to, about what makes sense and what doesn't make sense, about what type of lives we should live. Jesus, in John's Gospel, contrasts two kingdoms, power and truth. Power is holy. God is all-powerful, omnipotent, as some of our hymns have expressed it. It is a reminder indeed that God is holy power. There is a sense in which God brings all things into being and is able to sustain all of life. It is a remarkable affirmation of the God who is simply present and holds all things. But power, the service of God, is always in the service of truth. And so Pilate is quite right, having given himself over to the machinations of power. He's a complex character. Asks them, what is truth? Like any good politician preceding him and after him, he just wants to dodge the reality of truth and its implications for his life and his decision making. But let us argue the point in light of Scripture that power in the economy of God revealed in Jesus Christ is the power to love. It's the power to choose. It's the power to participate in God's creative, loving, renewing, liberating presence. God longs for us to experience a measure of power transformed by becoming citizens in a kingdom that is not of this world, but a kingdom that addresses this world and offers invitations to transformation of this world in subtle, quiet, repeated ways. Sometimes, dare we say it, even in loud and vibrant ways. Is this the Christ, the one who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Is this the one who speaks truth to power? Is this the one who invites us into his kingdom and to an experience of his family? Is this the one who reigns in our hearts, in our homes, in our communities, in our country, in our parish, in our nations, in our church? Before we spring to an immediate answer, it is good to reflect on the many and varied failings of human beings. And we recognize that in so many ways, and thus it is fitting, that every time we gather to worship, we make some form of confession, because we do fall short. We don't always live in response to truth. We don't always live in response to beauty. We don't always live in response to grace. All company included, yes, maybe, as the great Apostle Paul himself would say, the preachers are the chief sinners in this regard. And so it is always with a measure of hesitancy, rather than pointing fingers, but rather embracing the possibility of the reign of God, to ask, how then might we be those who participate in this remarkable kingdom? And maybe a question that would prove helpful. Is our use of power destructive or creative? To borrow a modern expression, are we building bridges or building walls? Are we breaking down or are we building up? Yes, we all have power. Sometimes we don't feel like it. Sometimes we feel that we are powerless, insignificant, amount to very little. But we all have power, even in terms of the ways in which we relate to those nearest and dearest to us, our neighbours, our family, our friends. How we might use our power speaks volumes of how we might be participating in the reign of God. And so Jesus Christ stands before us as an all-inclusive one who says to us, will you enter into a living discussion, debate, negotiation, sharing, deliberation, silence, prayer, worship, witness, prayerful trust in God? Will you ask the questions repeatedly? What is true? What is best? What is creative? And so we do make our confession on this day. For those aspects of our life where we have chosen that which proves false and destructive, where we, like Pilate of old and others, have sought to get ourselves off the hook, dodge the question by asking another question, trying to reduce our own measures of accountability, saying, for everyone else in the world, Christ is King, but not necessarily for me. Maybe at this moment, we need to acknowledge truly that Christ is King of kings, Lord of lords, of everything and of everyone, and invites us into a life that liberates rather than a life that enslaves. And wherever we are cooperating with love in a way that leads in the direction of creativity and freedom, there are hints of God and Christ's freedom. So, a simple invitation to us as we enter another week having worshipped. Firstly, we imagine Christ's King, Christ is King, and God's King. It is a sense of an inclusive reign that reminds us that even though we don't always feel it, we are gold. We are precious. We are valued. We belong to God. We are part of a remarkable family that spans the continents and spans the ages. We are included, motley crew that we are, in a great drama that is far larger than our imagination or our period in history. Reimagine your life and your place in God's unfolding family and kingdom. I found it helpful to reflect on my name. There is a sense in which it is a delightful name. I think my mother was inspired when she called me Kevin. Because as we all know, it means attractive at birth. And I've seen a few babies, and they're not all attractive. So my mother knew what she was thinking about when she saw me. I was a dog. I was gorgeous. I was like a monster, completely ill. Some of my earliest babysitters apparently used to wake me up after sleeping just to see me smile. Oh, enough to melt my heart. Kevin, my name is an invitation to knowing, even in the everyday, that a vision inspired by being named and in turn naming reality and light of who God is a constant, liberating, life-enhancing journey. We all have a name. We all have a story. We all have a life to live. And when do we get beyond the cheekiness and some of the tongue-in-cheek expressions, we have a place in God's heart that only we alone can fill. We are to be valued, and we should begin by valuing our own journey in light of who God is. And so in this coming week, reflect on the precious gift that you are in light of Christ as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Respond to all moments of spirit and grace that invite you to life in all its fullness, and repeat time and time again, close of one liturgical year and the beginning of another, repeat the simple reminder, Lord, I am open to you. Come and surprise me by your grace and your goodness. In another year, another reminder, that you, the one who is the Lord of Lords, is also able to enter a manger, become one of us, and in all your vulnerability, surprise us with your humanity, your goodness, and your love. These things we ask in Jesus' strong name. Amen. Let us pray. It is a topsy-turvy world, Lord. We often get the price tags all mixed up. Even in the church, Lord, we sometimes mix the price tags. We are easily flustered by people who have a sense of charisma and authority and presence. We easily give pride of place to those who have more, rather than recognizing that you are often the one at work in those who have less. We are often are flattered by those smooth in tongue and quick to offer us ready-made solutions, rather than learning the hard, painful, and repeated discipline of what it means to put a towel around our waist, to bend the knee, and to wash each other's feet. You, Lord Jesus Christ, are a remarkable expression of life at its best. And so as we come, we pray in your name and authority, for we recognize that you, the Lord of heaven itself, have entered into our vulnerability and our humanity. You have, to borrow the expression, walked the talk. You have been the one in the midst of the corridors and passages of power, and you have not buckled. You in John's Gospel stand firm before Pilate and remind us of all the significant truth, that your kingdom is not of this world, but enters this world in the movement of your Spirit, inspiring in turn our prayers, both spoken and unspoken, inspiring our longing for a world made whole. So as we face another week, we bring our prayers. We pray, yes, for this world in which we live, always in tumult, changing, facing a variety of challenges, insecurities and uncertainties, yet a world held in your love and grace. Help us work together with all those who seek to share the great rhythm of love and grace and goodness. Help us name all those moments that speak of your presence. And help us support and encourage each other, particularly praying for our leaders and those who exert influence in matters of policy, in matters of vision and direction, in matters of community structures and of society as a whole. We pray, Lord. We pray for those who serve communities day in and day out, often for mere wages, often overlooked, very seldom thanked. We pray that they would not lose heart. We pray for those in our own company who offer so much in and through the gifts of caring and befriending and coming alongside and encouraging and nurturing, and leading and guiding. Come strengthen, Lord, all those present here as part of Bellshill Central Parish Church and present in the community to which we shall return, to offer themselves unstintingly in love and service and devotion. Yes, Lord, we pray for those who are right at the end of their tether, about to give up. As Alan has wisely mentioned, there are many, even in this community, who carry very real experiences of grief and loss. As we gather to honour them this evening, we pray for those who might not be able to join with us, but carry grief and loss close to their hearts. We pray for those whom we have loved and lost. We pray particularly for those who have left us an example of compassion and mercy, and grace and kindness, of love and laughter, of life. Lord, receive our prayers, for indeed our prayers are always offered in your name. We recognize that even as we pray them, they are being answered. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and lives to respond ways in which you are answering our prayers. For these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow every tongue confesses King, glory.
Thank you.